So, housekeeping. With apologies, Councillor Murray, Allen, Ireland, Kenny, Needham, Sullivan, Tweed, and Jane Kennedy. Any other apologies to recall? No? Other than that, declarations of interest on the agenda before us today? No? There are some exempt items at the end of the agenda which we will deal with. Again, this is the point where any papers need to be kept confidential. So, we'll move into the meat of the agenda, colleagues. Two, minutes of the previous meeting. So that's the meeting held on the 22nd of February. Submitted for approval. Are they agreed? Thank you. Item three, minutes of the previous meeting on the 12th of April, 18. Are they agreed? Thank you, colleagues. So now moving on to item four, service delivery plan, pages 31 to 88. Now, we're going to have a presentation on this, so Phil, do you want to introduce the item?
That's it. Sorry. That's it, can't you? Jackie will take you through the performance over the course of the year 2017-18 in relation to our service delivery. At the conclusion of the presentation, then we'll be happy to take any questions or any specific details with it.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, I'm Becky Slipman, I'm the Integrated Risk Manager.
Can everyone hear you? You're all right,
then. Yeah. Okay, today we're going to look at the whole of the year last year, 17-18. Because it was easier than doing the quarters and really the whole year for you. So we're going to look at the service delivery plan. In December 2016, each function was asked to write a functional plan for 17-18. To include action points for the next 12 months. There were 56 functional plan action points. By the end of 17-18, 15 of these actions were complete. For example, simple operational fire safety assessment was fully embedded. Road safety strategy is now complete. NRAT is fully embedded in MFRA, as is National Resilience Training. Some of the actions had lots of parts to, for example, Prescott Fire Station is now complete, but there are aspects of the station merger programme still ongoing into this year, including St Helens and Silver Massey sites. As will development of the TVA site, website development, development and implementation of the SARA app, which will, it stands for Site Information of Risk and Hazard, and will eventually replace the SSRI programme that we have. The Strategic Management Group have approved functional plans for 2018-19 earlier this month, and action points from these plans will be included in the service delivery plan 18-19. So we look at our summary indicators for the year. Although it says March, that is actually the end of the year because it's a cumulative rolling target. So we look at where some of our we met some of our KPI targets. Primary fires, which are fires involving insurable loss, there were 102 less primary fires than 2016-17. Our attendance standard to have our first attendance of the clients at all life risk incidents within 10 minutes has a target of 90%. 17-18 we achieved this on 95.3% of occasions. And the carbon output of all buildings, it was slightly higher than last year at 87.2, still under the 88 target. This is a measure of CO2 per square metre per building. Accidental dwelling fires have decreased to 63 less than last year, and significantly that is 225 less than just 5 years ago when there were 1,153 ADFs recorded. Fatalities in accidental dwelling fires are a tragedy for any family. Sadly, during 17-18 we had 4 fatalities in accidental dwelling fires. This is the lowest number ever recorded in the history of the service. We continue to target those considered most at risk for home safety interventions, such as safe and well visits. Of the 91 injuries in accidental dwelling fires, 32 at 17 incidents were recorded as serious, meaning that the majority were considered minor, such as precautionary checks for slight smoke inhalation. Road traffic collisions were 49 less than last year. keeping with the reduction in incidence, there were 73 less injuries than in 16-17. 65 of the 299 injuries were recorded as serious. However, fatalities increased. In 16-17, there were 5 fatalities in RTCs. In 17-18, there were actually 10. They were 9 incidents at a variety of locations. There were 3 less deliberate dwelling fires in unoccupied properties than last year, which is 5 under target. And there were 10 injuries in deliberate dwelling fires compared to 19 last year, but no deaths. 3 injuries were recorded as severe and involved smoke inhalation. All 3 incidents were caused by people inside properties by residents. 92 deliberate fires in non-domestic premises was 23 less than last year. 25 incidents were in prisons, which is considerably less than in 16-17, when there were 48 incidents in prisons, 36 of which were all caused. KPIs where we were within 10% of target. Total emergency calls received, 22,980, which is over 500 more than in 16-17. We did have a lot of repeat calls to large incidents such as Spot Mix, the Paintball Centre in St Helens, and the warehouse in Park Lane. Back in August, we had 2,326 emergency calls, and 1,142 that were actually repeat calls to large incidents. Total number of incidents, 15,976. It's 1,376 more than 16-17. And this is due to an increase in fire types such as secondary fires, false alarms, and deliberate vehicle fires. If you look at the bar charts in your packs, you'll see that there were considerably more incidents in the first half of the year than sort of November onwards. Total number of fires, 7,318, is 118 more than in 16-17. There's no specific area that's to blame for that. So there's an increase in some fire types, such as accident dwelling fires and primary fires. Total secondary fires attended, there are 74 more than last year, and there was a spike in May when we actually had 635 incidents. We probably put that down to good weather and school holidays, and thought it would start to get lighter. The increases we might have expected in October and November around the street night bonfire night didn't really happen, and there was a 32% decrease in incidents over the bonfire period when compared to the year before. December to March, as expected, saw very low numbers of fires. Sickness absence for all staff is within 10% of target at 4.11%. This is due to an increase in absence primarily among uniformed staff. All staff absence, which is TDO09, was over target from November to February, but this has now fallen back to normal again. Sickness among operational staff peaked between October and March, with the highest recorded in December, with 5.8% shifts lost to sickness absence. Non-uniform did have 1 month when they went over in January. Pod upstairs have looked at possible themes and things that they can do. And apart from the usual flu, gastrointestinal, musculoskeletal, there aren't really any other reasons that we can find, no themes. When you compare our data to sickness data published in the Cleveland Report, which compares other fire and rescue services, we're average. We're not high, we're not low, we're just right in the middle. And KPIs where we've not met our targets this year, total special services attended. We've had a lot of discussion about special services because they generate income as well. Things like lift rescue are affecting entry, bringing in approximately £15,000 a year. And there are also a number of new incident types added during 17-18, including emergency medical response, gaining entry alongside Merseyside police, and assisting with searching for missing persons. We didn't know about these incidents when we set the targets the previous year, so this year we will adjust the targets accordingly. So what we've done in Impact has actually made it better with the performance, because it's not all bad news. Some of this is pretty clear, apart from anything else. Special services mainly included affecting entry, lift release, assisting other agencies, removal of objects, and we actually attended 79 suicide attempts this year. 54 four last year, so that's quite a considerable increase, and 15 of those were in October. False alarms are closely monitored. There were 1,115 more than in 1617. Aside from hospitals, the majority is sheltered accommodation. They're recorded as faults, they're recorded as cooking or use of aerosols. We don't want to discourage people living in sheltered accommodation to call. And deliberate vehicle fires continue to be a problem for ourselves and Merseyside Police. They're attributable to organised criminality, with 25 more incidents than last year and 115 over target. The station areas that had the most incidents were Old Swan, Toxteth, Speke, Croxteth. Home fire safety checks. Operational crews delivered 41,454 home fire safety checks last year, for 2018. There were 9,571 safe and well visits delivered by the advocates in the prevention team. Each officer averaged 892 in the year, which is an average of about 75 a month. 56.4% of HMSCs delivered by operational crews were taken from status reports which identify at least one member of the household over 65. And overall, operational crews, prevention officers and volunteers have delivered 51,989 HMSCs. And that is all I have to say.
Well, thank you very much. You know, this is, in terms of speaking of the outcomes from the IRMP, any specific questions?
Just a couple of comments, really. Just on the number of emergency calls that are made, there was something on national news this week from the ambulance service where they'd identified a number of people who, for want of a better term, are serial callers. Not because there's an incident or because of medical help, but primarily really because they had some mental health problems usually, or other such health issues, or they were lonely. And there was a paramedic who'd actually set up a group to try and identify those, make contact with those people. And I wonder if we can identify something similar, but if we have the need to, obviously. You know, do we get quite a number of people who ring on a regular basis for absolutely no reason at all, and it's perhaps just for some sort of assurance, for want of a better word. And if we do, could we perhaps have a look at that system? I think it's in Cumbria, or Lancashire, one of those areas. Yeah, very lonely. And also just wanted to comment, four fire deaths is clearly far too many, but it is quite remarkable in, you know, the way that we've had to rejig the service, and, you know, and long may it continue, that keeps falling really. And the wonderful work on the home fire safety checks as well, it's incredible what we're still being able to do with much reduced resources.
Okay, I'll pick them up if I may. But in relation to the character of horrific repeat callers, we don't have the same challenges that maybe the police do, and the ambulance service in that regard, just very native to the kind of business that we do, I suppose. Albeit we do get some repeat callers in relation to malicious calls, and we've seen in the presentation we've had some of our false alarms increasing over the period. Some of those are related to malicious calls rather than anything else due to apparatus. But we do work with police and ambulance colleagues where we are aware of the prolific offenders in that respect, and they share information with us, and we would share information with them, but they have the presence of the problem in the first instance, and it is, that goes in a nice very proper way, more often not related to mental health related issues, but we do share information on how to kind of tackle those collectively if we need to, but I know it's a problem for police and the ambulance service. The other thing I would say in relation to some of the kind of performance you've identified, Councillor Rennie, in regard to positives. When you look at the number of home fire safety checks completed, okay, we have extended that into safe and well visits, so that enhanced home fire safety check, and the, you know, all of our resources have been targeted more broadly to those who are most at risk, so people over 65 years of age who live alone, live in isolation. And as a result of that, you know, and that targeted approach, I think you have seen of that is the lowest recorded number of fire deaths ever in Merseyside, and that is testimony to the staff who are working around the prevention team and our operation crews in the target of our resource. But we also, you know, reference the fact that we've set ourselves, you know, an arbitrary target of over 60% of those visits being people over 65 years of age. So you could argue that a 56.4 is slightly below that target. However, you will also understand the significant amount of effort has been put into high-rise residential block post the Grenfell fire. And so we have targeted those people who live and reside in those premises, and that has had an impact on the target of vulnerable older people in domestic property. However, it will return back to target them over the course of the next number of years. But, you know, 4 or 5 deaths is an incredible performance in regards to the kind of challenge we face in Merseyside. The thing which Jackie probably alluded to in picking through some of the kind of most salient bits, if you look at our calls for false alarms, and some of the indicators you will see in front of you, you see those categorisations being red predominantly. What I would bring is some context really in regards to some of the work that was done. It's actually small increases in relation to false alarms, but increases nevertheless, and we will tackle that. But if it took you back probably 5 years ago, the authority changed the policy and how we respond to automatic fire alarm systems, and we've seen a reduction from that particular area from 4,203 to this year being 596. So a massive reduction in the number of unwanted calls that we've had to respond to, which has allowed us to target our resources in a more effective manner, which has allowed us to be more proactive and on the front foot in our communities. So again, you know, whilst for the reader, could be seen as kind of seeing a little bit of an increase, but in context, over 5 years ago, we were going to maybe a significant number more. Special service calls, and Jackie's kind of alluded to that to a greater or lesser degree, we've kind of coloured it red and green. There are things we can do around reducing unnecessary special service calls, but actually there's a significant number of special service calls that you and the public have wanted us to attend on your behalf. So elective emergency medical response, elective vulnerable providing assistance at road traffic collisions, assisting vulnerable individuals, putting people back into beds if they fell out, those kind of things are absolutely what the fire emergency services about. And so growing the number of special services, growing the number and the breadth of the work that we do, has got to be the right thing, so it's not necessarily perceived as a negative. I'll conclude on a couple of final points. One is around sick and substance. We have seen an increase around sick and substance over the course of the last 12 months. And I think over the winter period, where you will recall, there was what was declared or defined as the Aussie flu at that particular point in time. I think that was self-evident for a whole multitude of organisations which were challenged by that period of time. But our levels have returned back to levels below the 4% target that we had set, and remaining so over the course of the last few months. And then I will conclude on the point that Jackie's raised around special services, so assisting around suicide, and for members and for the public, they may not necessarily appreciate the number of calls that we attend in that respect, and the kind of challenge that faces our own staff in regard to their own well-being as much as dealing with the circumstances and the family. And we have seen significant increases this year, and that's on the back of increases over a period of years now for Merseyside and probably the UK more broadly. And we are doing some work through Firefighters Charity, through some of our staff, and through, you know, the representative bodies and the Health, Safety, Welfare Committee, where we are looking at giving people some insight into how they would deal with people who have got concerns over the well-being of individuals there, and it's linked into Zero Suicide campaign, and we will bring some more details back to members over the course of the next few months in regard to the progress that's been made in that particular area. And again, I'm happy to take any further questions, Chair.
Thank you. Thanks, Chair. It's not a question, it's merely an observation, and a congratulations really, because just under 52,000 on fire safety checks and well-being checks, that's no mean feat, that's excellent. And once again, you know, despite the cutbacks, despite what the service, what we as a locality are getting hit with, we can achieve that kind of thing. And I had the greatest pleasure to attend one day with the team around the Walton area, County Road, and it was a community reassurance, and our teams did home fire safety checks. And the amount of, you know, the public just basically opened the doors and said, come in, yeah, we want it, yeah, come in. And the confidence that are in our staff, by members of the public, and had we had a cup of tea in every house that we went to, I'd have had serious problems with my bladder. Because people would just, yeah, come in, and they were just so, and they were telling the things that they divulged, you can tell you, and whilst they're getting, you know, whilst they're getting the smoke alarms fitted, they're also telling the staff, and there's a questionnaire getting done about the health and well-being of them. And it was just tremendous, the fact that you can just get it across that front door. It's the, you know, the confidence people have in our staff, and that's, you know, 52,000, that's not bad shit. That really is. That means shouting from the rooftops.
And there's some counties who've struggled with 10,000. So we've always had, well, our political objective across the whole authority is to keep Merseyside as the safest part of the country. And this report seems to indicate, yes, there's a few things that bounce along the bottom, but broadly speaking, we're maintaining those political objectives, full-time firefighters, and the best of the service to keep the public as safe as possible. So, unless there's any other questions, colleagues, oh, sorry, yes.
Can we ask a question? I know the Deputy Chief has already picked this up, but on false alarms, I know there's a load of work around unwanted calls, but I just wanted to ask, how are we actually addressing false alarms where it's from an alarm fault? So, we've attended the false alarm, but it's actually an alarm fault for the business, the organisation. How are we addressing it, and do we have any performance information around improvement or enforcement notices issued? I guess that kind of makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. I suppose the kind of thing, where we get our calls from is a kind of key question. So from the business community, we've significantly reduced the number of responses to unnecessary calls. So the arrangements are in place where we won't attend unless they need to have a check and have confirmed or suspect there to be a fire at that location. And that has seen the number of calls from business premises reduced dramatically because they have responsibilities in that regard. What the authority did some time ago, though, was recognise the fact that we have vulnerable people in a number of residential accommodation, nursing homes and so on, and we've maintained our response to those particular localities because of the sweep and risk associated with them residing in those buildings. But all those buildings have fire alarm systems in and the potential for them to be actuated inadvertently or due to fault. So then you can split those two up into particular areas. One's a fault on the system and poor management, and then the other ones is the kind of nature of the occupancy of that particular building. So try as you might, the individuals who live in their own home to a greater or less degree might cook inappropriately and set the alarm off frequently. So from that category of individual, we would go and provide them with prevention advice, safety advice, how to cook safely and so on and so forth. So very much prevention focused. However, what we've also got is our protection teams who would then work with the responsible person, the care provider maybe, to say, actually, the number of calls we are attending now related to your poor management of your systems will be there on numerous occasions, and we do have some, you know, reasonably prolific offenders in that respect, and we start to work with them more intensively, identifying which alarm systems are defective, you know, work with them to replace detector heads and so on and so forth. Can introduce what is described as a double knock system. So if one alarm goes off, it doesn't send an alert to the fire and rescue service until a second one goes off, recognising that, you know, it's predominantly due to faults on systems, and we would work with them to replace their systems. As you follow that through, we've been pretty much in a supportive way where we've kind of consistently gone back and worked with them to prevent the number of calls that are giving us an unnecessary requirement to go. We have, you know, ultimately and still in the process of considering charging those individuals that should they not comply and manage their system effectively. However, given the numbers and the kind of the approach that we've adopted at this moment in time, we haven't sought to do that. But equally, we haven't enforced against, or we haven't prohibited the use of the building due to the alarm system, because we'd also recognise we've got vulnerable people in those properties. So very much it's been about working with the business and working with the responsible person, but with a little bit of an edge to that kind of conversation that they need to kind of to address that. The ultimate would be that we would stop attending because of the poor management. We haven't gone down that path because equally we recognise that this is sleeping risk, these are vulnerable individuals that we're trying to work with the business to prevent their calls. So, multitude of approaches really. Some of it is preventative, some of it is through protection, some of it is about non-attendance in the first instance, and some of it, so we've got kind of confirmation that the calls is a real, you know, fire rather than one that we're perceived to be. So it's still waiting for us, but I'm happy to bring back to members a little bit more detail around that. What we have seen over the course of the last number of years is an increase in the number of calls we're getting to residential premises. I'd argue, you know, that's probably linked into an ageing population as much as anything else, but nevertheless we are seeing increases there. I think we have to be a little bit more proactive in respect of that particular area of focus. Just to reassure you that if I was to compare and contrast Merseyside with other fire rescue services, particularly around our response to unwanted fire signals, we are probably the best in the country because of the policy that was adopted by the authority. You know, if you take it more broadly, we're the second best performance in relation to false alarms within the Metropolitan Fire Rescue Services.
And the second part of the question about do we have any data or performance information
about
improvements or enforcement purposes?
We haven't enforced against any care home premises on the basis
just
of...
Just generally, sorry.
Yeah, we can bring some data back for you in regards to the performance of prolific offenders and the actions that were taken against them, if that's what members would like.
Just generally, not necessarily for care
providers or care. Oh, around enforcement and prosecution, in the broader sense. Yeah, we can absolutely, we can bring some information back in regards to the actions that were taken. Again, if we look at, I suppose, some of the outcomes of Dame Judith Hackett's review, and there'll be a significant more emphasis on some of the protective work that we do in the communities that we serve. However, some of the work that or there's some recommendations contained within are putting the fire rescue services at the forefront of enforcement and prosecution and so on and so forth. And we've been there before. More latterly, we moved to a business support. So we've got support and businesses to comply. We've done a lot of work with our diverse communities to ensure that they knew what the rules of engagement were, and so they would comply without necessarily needing to enforce or restrict or prosecute. So we've been a little bit more supportive than we have in the past. However, given some of the recommendations from that back of review, we may well be that changes a little bit over the course of the next number of months. But I'm happy to bring some details and data back on that.
Maybe we can capture that as a community safety committee. Interestingly, we border with North Wales, and from this month, May 18, Wales have brought in the compulsory domestic sprinklers. So from now on, all new homes, flats built, will have to have sprinklers. And so over the period of some years, you'll start to see in Wales the safety of domestic property increase and the number of fires that reduce because they'll be knocked out in the corner of the room of origin. And we are lobbying on this to the government. Why didn't we do the same? We feel that our job is not just to put out fires, but to lobby for a certain environment for our people, which is safer. And we're going to see our neighbouring authority in North Wales have done something about it. They've got sprinklers now, and it'll be very interesting to monitor that. This is a campaign that was started by a Welsh Assembly member who started off in our control room here in Bootle. and also a control operator, went on to be an assembly member and had brought to fruition this domestic sprinkler agenda in North Wales, in the whole of Wales. And I will watch that very carefully. Okay, so if there's no more questions, the recommendation is that we approve the attached report for publication on the website. Agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. So thank you very much for the presentation, Jackie. So the next is item 5, lead member exclusive review, page 89 onwards. You want to just talk into this?
Yeah.
Then I'll give you a few thoughts.
Thank you, Chair. Members, this report you'll see at the outset is due to the fact that we now have a new fire and rescue national framework that requires us, as says at paragraph 4 of this report, to demonstrate accountability to communities for the service they provide. FRAs need to have scrutiny arrangements in place reflecting the high standard that communities expect. Members, some of you will be aware that we used to have a performance and scrutiny committee, but things were changed a few years ago. And those duties of scrutiny were subsumed into the audit and scrutiny committee, a new subcommittee that was formed. Given this new national framework, and also given the fact that we're going to have inspectors in the coming months, we felt it was an appropriate time to have a look at scrutiny arrangements for the authority to consider whether these were for purpose or whether any changes needed to be made. So you'll see, members, Kelly, the Democratic Services Manager, has done a lot of work in consulting various groups of people. So essentially, all the current lead members were consulted. The current lead officers were all consulted. The Chair of the Audit and Scrutiny Committee was consulted, along with the independent member who also sits on that committee. And as a result of that, you will see some common themes and common ideas for improvement were brought about. In paragraph 17 of the report, which is on page 92, you will see the suggested improvements with the common ideas that had emerged from this consultation, which include reintroducing the forward work plan that used to be part of the scrutiny, performance and scrutiny committee's function. As IRMP, the Integrated Risk Management Plan, is Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority's plan for the future, forward plan, it was felt quite strongly that scrutiny should be about that plan and essentially the objectives and performance against those objectives going forward. So as a result of that, some options were put together, and you will see that there are four options from paragraph 23 onwards. The first one, to perhaps establish two separate subcommittees rather than having audit and scrutiny in one subcommittee, and a reduction in members, which would ultimately create a small saving of just over £2,000. And then you've got the strengths and weaknesses of that option laid out for you. Option two on page 94 would be similar. But basically, rather than subcommittees, these would be full committees reporting to the authority. The third option would be to keep those functions together under one committee, but making that a main committee rather than a subcommittee. And the fourth option would be just to leave things as they are. This report was considered by the strategic management group, which is the leadership group in the authority. That group felt that a joint committee together under option three would seem the most appropriate. However, this report is with you to make some decisions, both about the type of committee or committees that you would like to see to improve scrutiny arrangements, and also what you would like to see in terms of the current lead member arrangement.
Thank you, Janet, and thank you to Kelly as well, and the officers who've polled opinions, taken these views, and pulled this report together. I think the problem that we have today is manifest. You know, I'm acting chairman. We've got a lot of apologies amongst the members, and a new group of members are to be appointed. So I think that probably the members need to be consulted a little more. Some of issues from each of the options, perhaps, rather classic British compromise. You know, take a bit from each of them. What we do need to do is improve our scrutiny. We need to give members independently an opportunity to look at the IRMP, which is the starting point, look at the outcomes which we've had a report on today, look at how we've achieved that, and basically members to ask any, you know, open agenda, ask any questions they want, to bring the leadership, whoever that be, in the new year, and the officers to account for what we've done. And we all know how scrutiny works in our own authorities. There's nothing new about that. Nobody here is a cabinet member. Everybody from their own authorities, everybody here is what is sometimes termed backbench, but you're probably all, I am, on a scrutiny committee at your home authority. And so we know how that works, and we bring those principles to play here. But I think for today, because we're somewhat down on numbers, my recommendation, and I'll put a resolution, is to note the paper as a direction of travel, but leave the mechanics of improving scrutiny in the next municipal year to the chief and chair to bring forward a proposal in time for the AGM. We will then have, I think the plan would be to have a scrutiny committee and to populate that in 9 members, the usual arrangement, opposition, independent members, supernumerary, a classic approach. But the mechanics of that we put together in the next fortnight, if colleagues would agree to that. So that's my proposal. Right, so I think we now move on to the pink paper, so I'm going to move the exclusion of press and public. All right, is that agreed?
Thank you.